I'm Beth King, and I'm here at the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Panama. I'm actually at the Culebra Point Nature Center, and which is not yet open to the public because the staff here is preparing an amazing exhibit and Curioso Center, which is going to be a hands-on learning center. And we're looking forward to that opening probably sometime around the beginning of next year, in January, February. Today, we'll welcome you to the November edition of our 2021 Deep Dive series. And today's speakers are Ashley Sharp and Nicole Smith-Guzman. They'll truly deep dive into the past as they present their talk, which is called A Tale of Three Villages, Exploring the Lives of Ancient Panamanians. Thanks to all of you for being here this morning. We would love to extend a special welcome to our funding partners who make research at the Smithsonian possible. Aprovecho para extender una muy especial bienvenida a nuestros amigos y colegas de Panamá y Latinoamérica. Muchísimas gracias por acompañarnos esta mañana. Please note that this webinar is being recorded and we will post it on our website in the next couple of days. So if you don't catch it all today, you can listen to the recording. We're delighted to share that the Smithsonian here in Panama we're now doing research again. And we ask that all scientists and fellows who are coming down to Panama to visit register in advance through our visitor services office on the web before planning their travel, because the number of people working at our facilities is still limited. Public visits to Punta Culebra Nature Center, Barro Colorado Island, Galeta Laboratory, and Bocas del Toro Research Station facilities will also resume soon, and you'll hear more about that. Please continue to check the public programs section on the STRI website at stri.si.edu for more details and updates. And of course, please check our news section for our most recent discoveries. This morning, it's a pleasure to introduce Ashley Sharp and Nicole Smith-Guzman. Ashley Sharp is a staff scientist and archaeologist here at the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute. She uses isotope geochemistry to examine human and environmental, particularly animal, interactions in the past, including how people adapted to different habitats through time and what effect their presence had on the landscape. Nicole Smith-Guzman is a postdoctoral fellow here at STRI. She's a bioarchaeologist and paleopathologist interested in the embodied biocultural diversity of the ancient populations in this area, particularly in evidence of infectious diseases and cultural body modification. Her other research interests focus on human malaria, paleoepidemiology, and the old and new world. She's conducted field work at sites throughout the Americas, in the Near East, and also in Africa. Okay, so let's go to the next slide, please. Okay, so before we turn it over to Ashley and Nicole, I ask that you save your questions for the end of the presentation and that you send your questions by clicking on the Q&A button at the bottom of your screens. Write your question and click send. And Sonia Tejada from the communications office is here today to help us read the questions out loud. So welcome Sonia too. All right, so now we'll turn it over to Ashley and Nicole and their presentation about the prehistory of Panama.
All right, well, thank you Beth for that introduction. And so today, my colleague, Dr. Nicole Smith-Guzman and I will be discussing a little bit about the lives of pre-Hispanic people in Panama. So we'll be focusing on three different villages, which although they were occupied around the same time, you'll see that the people who lived at these sites had very, very different lives. Nicole is, as Beth said, a specialist in bioarchaeology and paleopathology, which means she studies ancient health and disease in people. I study bone chemistry, specifically isotopes, and I look at what people were eating in the past and where they were moving around. What we hope to do in this presentation is provide you with this with an idea of the immense complexity of what was going on in people's lives in the pre-Hispanic past. So just so you know, because we are discussing bioarchaeology, there will be some images of excavations of human burials, as well as some images of human remains. We know that this is a sensitive topic for some people. We do respect that. So we just wanted to warn you ahead of time. So humans have lived in Panama for at least 13,000 years and probably more since the last ice age. Over the last 100 years, there've been an increasing number of excavations around the country. And we've been learning more and more about the people who lived in the southern part of Central America through those. Although ancient Panama might not be as famous as certain large civilizations that exist in the world, like the ancient Egyptians or the ancient Maya, there were still a large number and diversity of cultures and language groups that we know existed all throughout the southern part of Central America and northern South America. Many descendants of these communities are still alive today, and some of them are even archaeologists. So I'm going to turn it over to my colleague Nicole to discuss a little bit about bioarchaeology in Panama.
Thanks, Ashley. So bioarchaeology, or the specialized study of human remains from archaeological contexts, is one of the fields that is taking a larger role in the multidisciplinary approaches to archaeology in Panama. Bioarchaeologists are experts not only in human anatomy and osteology, so the study of the human body and specifically the skeletal system, but we're also trained in archaeological theory and field methods. Next slide. So bioarchaeologists can help in the field by identifying each particular bone, its orientation and any anomalies while it's still in the ground in its original context. And then this allows us to estimate the dimensions of each bone that helps prevent any unintended damage to the bone during excavation. We can also estimate age and sex of the individual while that person is still in the ground, again, avoiding any unintentional loss of information during excavation. And then we can also start to make interpretations in the field based on the body positioning within each burial. And then after the excavation, we typically construct a biological profile of each skeleton. So extracting even more information about each individual based on their bones. And we do this according to international standards of bioarchaeology, which then allow us to make comparisons between populations and across different areas of the world. And then with these data, we can begin to ask research questions specifically about the lived experience of particular human populations in the past. Next slide. So archaeologists at STRI have been working on excavations of mortuary features for many decades. And the analysis of the human remains from these sites has begun to illuminate previously unknown aspects of the lives of these ancient Panamanians. So in this presentation, we're going to focus on some of the findings from this analysis of human remains from three different sites. These are the sites of Sitio Sierra at the bottom left, Cerro Juan Díaz at the upper right, and then Cerro Brujo at the upper left. I'll hand it back to you now, Ashley.
So over the years, bioarchaeology has been increasingly coupled with isotope analyses because this allows us to really get into the life of an individual human. You might have seen some isotope research recently in the news. It's very common when they're studying Neanderthals and Ice Age animals, as well as mummies, trade in the past among different groups. And it's commonly used in forensics right now in order to identify people who, where sometimes DNA just doesn't work, isotopes can get at it. So you might ask, well, what is an isotope? An isotope is simply a different form of an atom based on the number of neutrons in its nucleus. So you can change the number of neutrons in an atom and it won't exactly change the atom to a degree. But because the neutron number varies, that means the weight might change a little bit. So you can see at the bottom here, we have three atoms. They're all carbon atoms. They're all the same element, but the number of neutrons varies just a little bit. So scientists have realized over 100 years of research of different isotopes that because of these variations in weight, specific isotopes behave in certain patterns in the environment. And it's with this basis that we study what's going on in people's bodies. So what can you do with an isotope? There's a few different things. You can examine what somebody was eating in the past, which is one of the foci of today. You can see where people are moving around. You can get a sense of what kind of conditions they faced, whether they had any nutritional problems or whether they were exposed to any pollutants. And you can get a sense of what environment they lived in and what kind of habitat they were living in. So all of these, of course, are connected. So as Nicole had mentioned, there are three villages we'll be focusing on: Cerro Brujo, Sitio Sierra, and Cerro Andes. The reason that we're studying these three for this presentation is because these sites were excavated a while ago. They've been the focus of intensive analysis for many, many years. We know a lot about the ceramic at the sites of the pottery. We know a lot about the stone tools. We know where people were living, but we haven't yet really studied the people themselves. So that's what me and Nicole have been working on the last several years. So some of the questions we've been asking include what sorts of activities and diseases can we see on the bones and teeth? And were there any sorts of changes in these pathological markers over time, any sorts of change in disease? We suspect that people were engaging in different activities over time across the generations. We also wanted to see, was there any variation in social inequality at the different sites? So social inequality is somewhat complex. It could be something like variation in status, so how much wealth someone has in a community, what their occupation is, but it could be something along the lines of how people of different age are treated in a society, as well as different sex. We also were curious about whether people moved around in the past at all. So people move for various reasons. It might have to do because they marry outside of their family, so they go somewhere else for the rest of their life. They might move because of some sort of exchange or traveling for their occupation. They can also move due to seasonality, which was very common in the past, even in Panama, where we have distinct rainy and dry seasons. So I'm going to turn it over to Nicole to discuss the first site, Sitio Sierra.
So Sitio Sierra is a site that's located on the northern bank of the Santa Maria River in Agua Dulce district of Coclé province in central Panama. This site was excavated by Dr. Richard Cook in 1971, 1973, and 1975. And Dr. Cook found evidence of two different cemeteries at the site, which are separated both geographically and chronologically. The early occupation cemetery contained mostly flexed human burials, which date between 40 BCE and 380 CE. And here, BCE is referring to before Common Era, and CE is Common Era. And the late occupation cemetery contained mostly extended burials, which date between 980 to 1155 CE. Next slide. Taking a closer look at the early occupation cemetery, here there were 35 human burials uncovered in the excavations. And as you can see in the plan of the excavation, which is on the lower left-hand side of this slide, most of these flexed human burials were found just east of this orange circle, which is representing a house floor at the site. And then there's another house floor, which is represented by the blue circle a little bit further towards the north, which also had a few burials associated with it. Looking at the demography of individuals found in these burials, we can see in the chart on the upper right-hand corner that individuals were found which corresponded to different age groups, but the majority of the individuals in these burials pertain to adults between the ages of 35 and 50 years and pertain to both male and female individuals. Next slide. Looking at the late occupation cemetery here, 13 human burials were found. And as I mentioned before, these are all for the most part in an extended position. And interestingly, they were all face down, so in the prone position. Here, looking at the demography graph, we see that very few non-adult individuals were buried in this cemetery. Actually, only one child was found in these burials. And the majority of individuals correspond to different adult age groups and pertain to both male and female individuals. Next slide. So some of the previous interpretations of this site, for the most part, made based on both material culture as well as faunal remains found at the sites, included that probably the population was egalitarian. This is because most of the burials were associated with burial goods that were mostly the same relative to each other. It was also thought that probably people buried here corresponded to members of the same family group because of their close association with the house floors, the domestic structures. And then it was thought that some individuals may have had special occupations based on specialty items which were found nearby the burials. So some of the occupations included a carpenter and an axe maker. And then looking specifically at the faunal analysis, we see that there were some instances of ritual feasting going on in these domestic structures at the site. And that based on the numerous amounts of marine resources, especially marine fish remains found at the site, probably this population had close ties to the coast. So it's important here to understand that these interpretations were made based mostly on the early occupation cemeteries. So we don't know necessarily if they extend to include that late occupation of the site as well. And then the goals of the osteological analysis or the bone analysis that we're going to be presenting here include confirming or adding more details to some of these interpretations, specifically whether the population was egalitarian or not. Are there social differences, as Ashley was mentioning earlier? And what people were doing at the site, were they trading with individuals at the coast or were they actually going to the coast themselves? Next slide. So in looking at the highlights of the bone analysis, one of the first things that was discovered was that the individual that was interpreted as an axe maker based on these numerous lithic remains that were found right next to the burial, as you can see in the upper right field photo, this person also contained some bony growths within his ear canal, which typically only show up in individuals who are spending a lot of time doing aquatic activities, and particularly aquatic activities in cold water. So our interpretation of finding these bony growths in ear canals in Panama is that these individuals are probably doing breath-held diving activities in search for marine shells in the seasonal upwelled cold water of the Gulf of Panama. And so this finding in this individual is showing us that this person was not dedicating all of his time to one specific trade, but was probably doing multiple activities over the course of his life, including some activities far away from the site along the coast. Next slide. So one of the unique findings of in terms of the paleopathology or looking for disease markers on the bones was that many individuals at this site had inflammatory and degenerative changes to their joints, which appeared to be more common here than in other sites in pre-Columbian Panama. So these might be pointing to the level of activity in the population, that these individuals were more active or were more mobile potentially than other villages in pre-Columbian Panama. Next slide. In terms of infectious disease, we see quite a lot of evidence of specifically a treponema pallidum, which could be either yaws or syphilis in this population. This suite of diseases was not uncommon on the isthmus in pre-Columbian times. So this is not a unique feature at the site, but here we see some characteristic lesions which appear on the frontal bone, so on the forehead, on the clavicle, the collarbone, and on the inside of the shin bone or the tibia. Next slide. One of the more unique features in terms of infectious disease at the site was these erosive and inflammatory lesions, which appeared on the nasal bones, inside the sinus cavities, and on the inside of the rib surfaces of individuals. We still need to do more research to pinpoint exactly what was causing these lesions, but most likely this is either an infectious disease such as a tuberculosis, or also could be caused by some of the chronic skin diseases which are present on the isthmus, or could have something to do with contaminants, environmental factors, such as individuals spending a lot of time indoors in a smoky structure. Next slide. So some interesting patterns start to pop up if we compare these different activity markers and disease markers between the early and the late cemetery individuals. So here on this chart, we're seeing percentage of individuals affected in both early and late cemeteries, and then they're broken up by activity markers and disease markers. And here we see that rates are pretty consistent between the two cemeteries, but we also see a trend in that late cemetery individuals do seem to be experiencing more signs of activity markers and disease markers than early individuals. So potentially both activity and disease is going up over time. Next slide. And then if we overlay on this same chart, the data on the sex of the individual, we see some additional interesting details that pop out. So if we look again at the activity markers, the individuals who are being affected by this increase over time seem to be predominantly male individuals. And the individuals affected by this increase in disease markers tend to be more commonly female individuals. So female individuals appear to be bearing the brunt of this increase in disease over time, whereas males may be becoming more active over time. So now I'm going to turn it back over to Ashley, who's going to discuss the ways that the isotope results intersect with these results I've presented.
Okay, so on to the isotopes. The two main isotopes that we use in the study to determine diet were carbon and nitrogen. We test these from bone collagen. Collagen is just a fancy word for bone protein. Now, if you've ever broken a bone before, you know that your bone repairs itself over time, hopefully. And so what's really going on in your bone is it's constantly replacing tissue, which means when we are actually testing bone collagen for those isotopes, we're looking at a composite of the last several years of someone's diet. Now, when we graph out carbon and nitrogen on in terms of the data points, they tend to look like a graph like this, where carbon is on the x-axis and nitrogen is on the y-axis. What carbon is telling us is what type of plant people were eating, whether it was a grassy plant like maize or corn, or whether it was a leafy plant, typically most of your fruits, wheat, as well as most vegetables. Grasses tend to, they have a different type of photosynthesis compared to most of the leafy vegetation, and that gives them higher carbon values. So people who eat those grasses, including maize, tend to have higher carbon in their bones, whereas people who eat mainly wheat and fruit and things of that nature tend to have much lower carbon. So on this graph, you can see there's a distinction between people on the right side from ancient Mexico, that was this particular study, who were eating a lot of corn, versus people in Neolithic Europe who had no access to corn, and they're all eating a lot of wheat and fruit, so they have much lower carbon. Now the y-axis, as I said, is showing nitrogen. That's really determining how much meat somebody is eating. So your top carnivores, like lions, tend to have very, very high nitrogen. Humans who mainly just eat meat have high nitrogen, whereas your vegans who don't eat any meat at all would be very low on this chart. Another thing that determines nitrogen is marine fish and marine mammals. So if you're eating a lot of marine fish and mammals, you tend to have much higher nitrogen than anybody else. So with that, if we look at City of Sierra and what we got from the results of testing the bone collagen of these individuals, we see that everyone's somewhat shifted toward the right-hand side of the graph, which means everyone's eating some amount of maize, which is not a surprise. We already knew that corn had been domesticated long before this site was occupied. However, what's interesting is that the earlier occupation, the ones in the light green, are eating more corn or maize than the later occupation in the dark green. If we look at males versus females, we see that in the early occupation, there's very little difference between what males and females are eating. So everyone's eating the same thing. But if we look at the later occupation, the males who are the squares are shifted more toward the maize side of the spectrum than the females who are the triangles. So it seems that there might be a difference in what males and females are eating in that time. Now, Nicole had mentioned that axe maker who also had evidence of cold water diving in his ear. That individual had the highest nitrogen value of any of the males we tested in the early occupation. Now, nitrogen, as I said, increases on the basis of how much marine fish you're eating and how much meat you're eating. So if this individual was spending a lot of time near the coast doing deep water diving, that might have been why he had high nitrogen. He was eating a lot of fish. So the other isotope that we're interested in is strontium. This can help determine how people are moving around on the landscape. Strontium differs based on the types of rock in the landscape, so it's based on geology, as well as the age of rocks. So what strontium does over time is that it dissolves into the water, it gets absorbed into plants and animals, and humans eat these plants and animals and drink the water and obtain the local strontium value from wherever they're living into their bones and their teeth. When we're testing strontium, we usually like to test tooth enamel because it's more durable and more reliable. It also determines, it also doesn't change over time. So enamel, it only grows once and it never replaces itself like bone does. Whatever strontium value you have when your teeth are first forming is going to be what remains in your teeth after you die. So we can figure out where somebody was when their teeth were first forming. The results that we're going to be showing you in this presentation are the earliest teeth we could get from individuals. So it's mostly from wherever they were when they were infants. We can compare that to what strontium value would expect in the area where they were found, their body was actually covered, to see whether they were born and died in the same location. Now to do this, we do need somewhat of an idea of what strontium is on the landscape. And in some countries, as you can see, like in the United States here, it varies quite a lot. There have been a lot of strontium baseline maps made for different parts of the world, but unfortunately no strontium map yet exists for Panama. However, because strontium varies based on the geology, we have an idea of what it should be based on geological maps. And fortunately, there are a lot of very good geological maps for Panama, like this one here. The western side of Panama that you see in the dark red is actively volcanic. There are active volcanoes today. Volcanic rock tends to have very, very low strontium values. In the meantime, limestone and older rock tends to have higher strontium values, and anybody living near the coast tends to have the same strontium value around most of the planet, which we know it's around 709. So we tested a number of animals recently, including small land snails and little rodents and opossums from all over Panama. And although this isn't a really good baseline map, it gives us an approximation of what we would expect the strontium to be like at the sites we're studying. The animals matched up what we expected from the geology in different areas, with the lowest ones, the ones in red and orange, coming from the more volcanic areas, and the ones in blue having the highest strontium because they're near the coast. So if we compare this with six individuals we've tested so far at Sitio Sierra, three from the early occupation and three from the later occupation, we see that the people, none of them, except for one, really match up with the local baseline. The three earlier individuals we tested all compare with each other, but they're higher than the expected baseline. Whereas two of the later occupation people are much, much lower. They're coming from an area probably further inland where there's more active volcanism. So this somewhat lines up with the data we already have from the early and late occupations. The early occupation, as Nicole had mentioned, there's a lot of marine fish at the site from that period. And there's one individual, that axe maker, has evidence of cold water diving in his ear. So it seems that those people probably had more involvement with the coast. They may have even been moving back and forth from the coast. They may have been more seasonal. And that might be why they have higher strontium. Whereas the other individuals in later occupation weren't doing this. So when we summarize everything we know from Sitio Sierra, we see that there are two very different types of people living at the site, both in the early occupation and late occupation. In the later occupation, we see more evidence of pathologies and disease. We see that that's particularly so for women. There's in the early occupation, people are all eating the same thing, but later occupation, women have more pathologies and they're eating less maize than the men are. So there's some sort of social distinction going on in that late occupation. We also see that, as I said, the two occupations seem to become born in different locations. So we don't know if these two groups were related at all. We haven't done the DNA, but it would be interesting to see in the future whether there was any connection between these two different, these two groups who occupy the site centuries apart. And I'm gonna turn it over to Nicole to talk about, to introduce the next site, Cerro Juan Díaz.
Yeah, so Cerro Juan Díaz is moving further south along the Azuero Peninsula. And this site was both a domestic and a mortuary use site, which was occupied between about 200 BCE all the way up until the time of Spanish contact in 1520 CE. Next slide. Here again, Dr. Richard Cook directed excavations at the site over about 10 years in the 1990s. And during these excavations, hundreds of human burials were uncovered, which pertained to different cemeteries, which were separated, again, both chronologically and spatially at the site. Within these burials, there were a number of diverse mortuary artifacts that were found. Some of them appear in this photo on the right-hand side of the screen. And it is important to note here that not all of the human remains have been analyzed to date, but here we're gonna present the results of some of the ones that have been analyzed. Next slide. Okay, so in terms of disease markers, here there were a lot of signs of non-specific infections. And so by that I'm referring to potentially nutritional deficiencies or systemic disease, which showed up in the form of anemia and systemic inflammation on some of the long bones. Interestingly here, children were especially affected by these non-specific infections at the site. Next slide. And then at this site, we also saw quite a lot of poor dental health, which appeared in the form of dental decay. So carious lesions or cavities to the teeth. We also saw a number of abscesses. And again, here, children were not spared from these dental lesions. So here on the bottom left-hand side, we see the dentition of one child individual from Cerro Juan Díaz, who has a number of carious lesions to the teeth. and who also has a abscess that's formed around a deciduous tooth, so a baby tooth. This is not very common to find in the past. And then it's also worth noting that a lot of this, these signs of dental decay were also accompanied by signs of dental crowding. So there may be a link here between potentially a soft diet that wasn't providing enough biomechanical stress for development of the jaws, which was also a very sugary, sticky diet, such as that that's usually associated with a lot of maize or corn in the diet. So next slide. And then if we do a similar comparison between early and late components of the human burials at Cerro Juan Díaz as what we looked at Sitio Sierra, here I'm separating early and late by a threshold of 700 CE. We see again that both bone and dental lesions at the site appear to be increasing over time. Next slide. So then if we overlay again the sex data on this previous chart, comparing early and late individuals, we see quite noticeably at this site that children are showing up in these disease markers. So children are typically going to show up as the indeterminate sex category because they haven't developed enough to show differences between their skeleton in terms of sex. And you see, especially in the bone lesions, there's a high proportion of children that are showing up as having these lesions. But then if we look only between male and female adult individuals, we again see, like Sitio Sierra, at Cerro Juan Díaz, female burden of disease appears to be what's increasing over time. So females are being disproportionately affected by this increase in disease over time. And now I'm going to turn it back over to Ashley for the isotopes.
All right, so here is again one of those diet graphs that I showed you earlier. And just to orient you, the x-axis, remember, is the carbon. So it's telling us what type of plant people are eating. The y-axis is how much meat people are eating and whether it's marine food. We've done 45 people so far from Cerro Juan Díaz, as you can see here. And as you can see, compared to what happened at Sitio Sierra, there's a much wider distribution of diet going on, with people shifted much further up on the nitrogen axis, which means there's a lot of people eating marine food. As you can see with the squares, which are the adult males, again, they're shifted a little bit more toward the maize or corn side of the spectrum, whereas the females, which are the triangles and the circles, which are mostly all the children, overlap each other and aren't quite as high as most of the males. Now, if we take time periods into consideration, things get interesting. First of all, we got this group of people in orange in the upper right hand of the graph. Those people are eating a lot of marine food and a lot of maize or corn. They're some of the earliest people we tested, and they overlap pretty well. So what we think is going on at that time, there's more of an egalitarian diet. They're all eating a lot of maize, they're all eating a lot of fish. This is somewhat what we saw at Sitio Sierra, where everyone in the earlier occupation were eating the same thing. But then when you get to the later time periods at Cerro Juan Díaz, things get a little bit more complicated. There's a much wider distribution in diet. And we think what might be happening there is that over time in central Panama, you had the rise of chiefdoms and increasingly complex social distinctions and social order in society. Populations exploded. So what we think might be happening here is that you've got people with different occupations, different status ranks, and so they're eating different things. And yet we still see this distinction between what males and females are eating, especially over time. Why would diet have anything to do with gender? And we think there might be a few different reasons, although we're not exactly sure what it might be right now. One possibility is that it was incidental, not something they had intended in life, and it had to do with what men and women were doing during the day. There's a clue that this might be part of the answer because men, I should say women and children overlap. That means they're eating the same thing. It could be that the women and children are living in the village and have a wide variety of different plants that they're eating, whereas the men are going to the field, maybe they're doing agriculture and farming, or maybe they're going fishing for the day. And they carry with them something that's made out of maize. It could be a maize drink. It could be some sort of dried maize bread. We don't know if tortillas existed in ancient Panama, but maybe they had something similar to tamales. There, on the other side of the list of possibilities, it could be something that was intentional, in which men and women did eat distinctly different diets for some reason. There is some evidence of this when the Spanish arrived across the Americas of men and women in some societies eating different diets. For example, in certain parts of the Andes, men would often engage in these big festivals where they would drink chicha beer, which was a type of alcohol made out of maize. However, in ancient Panama, we're not sure so far if anything like that ever existed. But it does seem from the isotope evidence, at least, that there is a distinction in what men and women are eating over time. So one last interesting point I want to make point out are some of the children who show up as outliers. One of them is in the far upper right hand of this graph. You can see that child is eating a lot of fish and a lot of maize, more than anybody else we've tested so far. And then there are two other children from the same time period who aren't eating much fish at all. So the answer why these children are so unusual lies in what their bones look like, and Nicole can explain that.
Yeah, so looking at the two children that had very low nitrogen values, both of these children also had both bone and dental lesions, which suggested that they were suffering from poor health right around their time of death. Interestingly, both of these individuals were also buried with many colorful marine shell ornaments. This was not uncommon for children to be buried with marine shell in the past in Panama, but this does stand in a sort of ironic contrast with the fact that these two children were also receiving very low quantities of marine protein in their diets. Next slide. And then that individual that was showing up as an outlier in the upper right quadrant of the chart was also in a somewhat unique position. So this individual was a child around the same age as those two previous children, but this individual did not show any pathological lesions, so no disease markers on their bones or teeth. And quite interestingly, this was the only primary burial in this multiple individual tomb. When we talk about primary burials, we're referring to someone who has died recently, and so all of their bones are still in articulation and anatomical position within the burial. And so this person was standing in contrast to all the other individuals who were buried here, which pertain to both disturbed human remains, but also quite a number of secondary bundle burials. So these are individuals who passed away at some time previous to the burial event and whose remains were gathered up and usually cleaned and bundled together to be placed in this grave. So in taking all of this information together, it does seem that this person may have been an important child during life, perhaps a high-ranking individual for whom this whole burial event was devoted. Okay, I'll hand it back over to you, Ashley.
All right, so looking at how often, if at all, people moved around at Cerro Andes, it looks like when we compare those 45 people distributed across these three different time periods in these gray bars here, they're all roughly the same. Now, the baseline of strontium around Cerro Andes varies somewhat, but it's actually around that average that all three of these bars have. So most people are from Cerro Andes or the nearby vicinity by several kilometers. We have no extreme outliers. We have nobody coming who was from some area near the coast. which is surprising because there is an awful lot of marine fish at the site. We also don't have anybody coming from the far interior part of Panama as well. If we compare these people to the ones from Sitio Sierra, they don't even overlap. Even though Sitio Sierra isn't that far from San Juan Díaz, the geology of Sitio Sierra is different. So that means that the people from that area and San Juan Díaz were simply not moving back and forth that often. Maybe they did within their own lifetime, but they didn't do it permanently. So to compare or combine everything we've learned so far about San Juan Díaz, we see, much like Sitio Sierra, over time there's an increase in pathologies at the site, an increased difference in or variety of what's happening to different types of people, including the diet and those pathologies, which we think might go hand in hand with the fact that there's a rise in populations at that time and social distinctions and social occupations. People are simply doing different things. We see this distinction between males and females increases as well. The same thing we saw at Sitio Sierra. They're eating different things over time, and it might be that women are engaged in different activities than men. Children in some parts of the site seem to be given a special diet if they're sick, which is very interesting to see this far back in time. And we also note that not many people are moving around, so that means that there doesn't seem to be any engagement with distant areas, at least from what we can tell so far with the strontium. So lastly, we're going to focus on the village of Cerro Brujo, which is very different compared to the two we've seen from central Panama. And Nicole can explain the background on that.
Yeah, so Cerro Brujo, in contrast to the previous two sites, is a mostly domestic site, which was up on a hilltop overlooking the Almirante Bay in Bocas del Toro province. This site was excavated in 1970 by Olga Linares and Tony Rainier. Next slide. Here there was only one formal burial that was uncovered at this domestic site. This pertained to an individual who was found in a flexed position and face down within a midden or a domestic refuse dump. Interestingly about this individual was that when we took a piece of their bone to test for radiocarbon dating, they ended up being, the radiocarbon dating showed that they lived approximately 200 years after the site had been abandoned, or at least the domestic part of the site had been abandoned. So potentially this was showing quite a long social memory associated with this individual's community and this site up on the hilltop. Next slide. So when we did the bone analysis of this individual, we found that this was a adolescent female individual whose skeleton contained quite a lot of disease markers. So anemia, also some growth disruption seen in the teeth, and also this widespread systemic inflammation that shows up on the long bones. Next slide. And then the most prominent disease marker that we saw in the skeleton of this individual was a large tumor that appeared on the right upper arm bone or humerus of this individual. And this tumor indicated that likely the other disease markers that we're seeing on the skeleton were all caused by this type of bone cancer, probably osteosarcoma. It's important to keep in mind that bone cancers are very rare. Primary bone cancers are very rare in modern populations. And so to find evidence of bone cancers in archaeological sites is even more rare. So this ended up being the first and only evidence of an ancient bone cancer in Central America that we've found so far. And I'll turn it back over to you, Ashley.
So when we look at the two sites we've compared so far, Cerro Juan Díaz and the two occupations at Sitio Sierra, here we see the distribution of diet of all those people. We would expect the individual from Cerro Brujo to have very high nitrogen, because she lived on the coast and there was a lot of marine fish in the deposit where she was buried. However, she showed up very much at the bottom of the chart with the people who probably weren't eating much marine fish at all in their life. And this was sort of a surprise. When we did the strontium, we expected she would have the highest strontium of anybody we've tested. We expected her to have the marine value because she was buried within sight of the coast. You can see a picture of the top of Cerro Brujo on the left-hand side of the screen. She's within sight of the coast. She should have close to the marine value. Instead, she had the lowest strontium value of anybody we've tested to date. She must come from an area with volcanic geology. The hill where she was buried, Cerro Brujo itself, is made of limestone, which again, limestone has very high strontium. There's no way she could have come from there. So with all of this combined, we think she may have been subject to a very unusual and special burial. She had a very obvious and unique bone tumor that might have been the cause of her death. She clearly wasn't living her life near the coast because she had fairly low nitrogen and wasn't eating a lot of marine fish in life. She might have been born somewhere in the western side of Panama where we have very low strontium values like that. I think perhaps modern Chiriquí or inland Bocas del Toro. What we think might have happened, because the site where she was buried was occupied hundreds of years before she was buried there, her people might have had some sort of connection to this abandoned site. It might have been where their ancestors had once lived. But somehow they remembered it. They brought her all the way there, either close to death or after death, and she was deposited on the top of the hill. We don't have any written records of burial practices and mortuary rituals from this time because it was long before the Spanish arrived. But this combined information from the pathological analysis that Nicole did and the isotope data gives a very detailed understanding of what happened during her burial. We just don't know why this occurred. So to summarize what we've discussed in this presentation, you can see that the various activities that went on in people's lives at the different sites were not particularly comparable. There are lots of different things going on over time and varied over space as well. There is interesting evidence for social inequality, and that especially emerges when we get the rise in chiefdom societies in central Panama. It could have been because there's an increase in social occupations going on. People are eating different things. They're engaged in different activities, leaving different markers on the bones. And there seems to be an increased distinction what men and women are doing over time as well. We do have some evidence of people moving around, but not as much as we had expected, except for that one individual at Cerro Brujo who might have been moved after she died. So as I said at the beginning of this presentation, we wanted to give you an idea and hopefully appreciation of the immense amount of complexity going on in people's lives in the pre-Hispanic past. With every year, there's new and improved excavations going on, new methods, new techniques. They can address questions that before we thought were impossible to answer. We know there's a lot left to learn, but we're sure that in the future, there are going to be a lot more new discoveries and very interesting stories to tell. So we have a number of people to thank. Not all of them are listed here, but in particular, I want to thank our friends at STRI who have helped us out. The Panama Ministry of Culture, CENACIT, the various people who have helped us doing the lab analyses, as well as the original excavation projects. And with that, we can take some questions.
So thank you very much. That's fascinating, as usual. And we will pass it over to Sonia Tejada, who will read the questions from the chat. So please, from the Q&A. So please write your questions in the Q&A.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here. I have one question. It says, how do you identify where there were maybe burial grounds? What clues are there that suggest where you should excavate?
So my answer is that often in my experience, we don't know, but Nicole, you might have a different answer.
I guess I would just point out that most of the sites that we've discussed here in this presentation were actually found by people that live nearby the sites who, for some reason, either archaeological remains were eroding out of the ground, or there was some looting activities that alerted people to the fact that there was an ancient burial ground at the site. So a lot of these excavations were actually done as a sort of rescue operation to prevent further damage of these sites.
Thank you, Nicole. I have another one. At Sitio Sierra, you mentioned that a DNA analysis would help you understand the relationship, if any, between the individuals in the older and newer burial sites. Do you have the tissues needed to do those DNA studies? Is this work expensive to do? Do you do this work at STRI or at another lab?
I can take that too, Ashley, if that's okay. We do have colleagues that are working on active ancient DNA projects with ancient human remains in Panama. The remains at Sitio Sierra have not been included in that project yet, but we do have plans to include them in the near future. Typically, the areas of the skeleton that are most best preserved for ancient DNA analysis are the inside of the ear bone, so what we call the petrous portion of the temporal bone. This tends to be protected within the cranial vault, and so is a great tissue for extracting ancient DNA. And then also sometimes we use teeth, which tend to have genetic material protected beneath the enamel of each tooth. It does tend to be an expensive project. So typically we would ask for grant funding for this type of research, but our colleagues are located and use a lab in Italy. So there are currently no ancient DNA labs within Panama. So usually we'll have to send samples outside of Panama in order to do this type of analysis.
Interesting. Thank you, Nicole. I have another question. You have mentioned a few times that people were buried in a face down position. Could you comment on this? Was this a common practice?
Yeah, I can take this one too. So this was a common practice, but only in a certain period of time. So around between 700 CE and 1000 CE, this does tend to show up in especially burials in central Panama. We don't know specifically what, if there was any meaning associated with this burial position. In some other cultures in different parts of the world, people might have been buried down to mitigate a certain spiritual belief. So a lot of times people who had some sort of power during life, and especially a spiritual power, would be buried face down so that that power would go down into the earth instead of being faced up and potentially affecting living people. We don't know if that is related to what's going on here in Panama, or if it was just a fashion or a mode of burial that was desired at that period of time.
Thank you. I have another question here. Can you summarize the evidence of the rise of chieftains in the cultures you're studying? Is it based on colonial narratives or are they based on archaeology?
The rise of chiefdoms, is that?
Yes.
Yes, that is based on the other archaeological evidence. So these sites, all three of them have been excavated a while ago. And there have been a number of studies of the habitations, the pottery, the stone tools and things like that. We do know that the populations were fairly large and they had grown over time. We know, of course, from the Spanish records that when the Spanish arrived, there were full-scale chiefdoms with a head individual in charge and a number of other people below that. But in terms of the earlier time when we get to, say, the early part of Serra Juan Díaz between 200 and 500 AD, that was when we start to see the development of this, and we don't exactly know what went into that development. That's something that's still under investigation.
Thank you. I have another question here. Do projects that work with indigenous human remains consult or ask permission with descendant communities in Panama?
Yeah, yes. I can take that one. Oh.
Yeah.
You want to take it, Ashley?
Yeah, you can, Nicole, you can.
Okay. So any project that's excavating human remains, and especially bioarchaeologists have an ethical obligation to always consult with descendant groups that are associated with these individuals that have been excavated or that are being excavated. And we always try to abide by the wishes and the beliefs of these descendant groups. When referring to Panama specifically, most of the archaeological investigations, especially the ones that have uncovered human remains, are found most commonly on the Pacific coast and especially in the Parita Bay area of central Panama, where we don't have surviving indigenous groups that retain their cultural practices and traditions. However, it's very likely that individuals who are still living in the villages surrounding these areas contain descendants of these original groups who lived here. So in these particular places, we do communicate with these local communities, and we share results. We invite them to participate in excavations and that type of thing.
Wonderful, thank you. We have a lot of questions, but we can only take one more, and the rest, we will present you a link, an email, where you can send us your questions. And it's, you said that bone cancers are rare even now, and now so with the ancient remains. Does it seem to have been environmental in nature? Were there other signs of cancer or particular illness in that individual?
So the specific type of bone cancer that seems to have affected that particular individual is osteosarcoma, which is thought to have a genetic component. So thought to be somewhat hereditary, but also could potentially have environmental factors that contribute to the development of that particular cancer. We don't know exactly those environmental factors. That's been suggested in the medical literature, but it's not confirmed. So this is one of the situations where a paleopathologist such as myself are kind of waiting for the medical consensus in order to be able to apply this to the past. But it's within the realm of possibility that both genetic and environmental factors would have contributed to the cancer seen on this individual. In terms of other signs of illness on this particular individual, she did have quite severe anemia and quite severe inflammatory lesions on her skeleton. Both of these are associated with that specific type of cancer, osteosarcoma. So it's quite likely that these severe disease markers that we see on her skeleton, other than the bone tumor itself, were caused directly by this bone cancer.
Okay, well, I'd like to thank Ashley and Nicole for an amazing presentation. Thanks to everyone for your questions. If you have more questions, there are some more questions in the Q&A. Please feel free to send them to strywebinar@si.edu, and we'll make sure that Ashley and Nicole get them. and can answer you by email. And thank you very much for coming today. And we'll welcome you to the next webinar in December. So see you soon.